Okay, let's go to 434 because I think this is a very important verse. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinaha. So very, very important, very instructive and very illuminating verse. Do you know which one I'm talking about? Yeah, there we go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Om Agyanati Mirandasya Gnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nitya Ananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Pancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Eva Cha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. So I offer my humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis. I humbly request you to please give me your merciful blessings, so that I am empowered to speak something that will be enlivening for all of us. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, thank you.
Hare Krishna. So this is a Bhagavad Gita verse from chapter 4, and the verse number is 34. It goes like this. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinaha. Translation. And purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Just try to learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. Inquire from him submissively and render service unto him. The self-realized souls can impart knowledge unto you because they have seen the truth. Purport. The path of spiritual realization is undoubtedly difficult. The Lord therefore advises us to approach a bona fide spiritual master in the line of disciplic succession from the Lord himself. No one can be a bona fide spiritual master without following this principle of disciplic succession. The Lord is the original spiritual master, and a person in the disciplic succession can convey the message of the Lord as it is to his disciple. No one can be spiritually realized by manufacturing his own process, as is the fashion of the foolish pretenders. The Bhagavatam 6.3.19 says, Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. The path of religion is directly enunciated by the Lord. Therefore, mental speculation or dry arguments cannot help lead one to the right path. Nor by independent study of books of knowledge can one progress in spiritual life. One has to approach a bona fide spiritual master to receive the knowledge. Such a spiritual master should be accepted in full surrender, and one should serve the spiritual master like a menial servant without false prestige. Satisfaction of the self-realized spiritual master is the secret of advancement in spiritual life. Inquiries and submission constitute the proper combination for spiritual understanding. Unless there is submission and service, inquiries from the learned spiritual master will not be effective. One must be able to pass the test of the spiritual master. And when he sees the genuine desire of the disciple, he automatically blesses the disciple with genuine spiritual understanding. In this verse, both blind following and absurd inquiries are condemned. Not only should one hear submissively from the spiritual master, but one must also get a clear understanding from him in submission and service and inquiries. A bona fide spiritual master is by nature very kind towards the disciple. Therefore, when the student is submissive and is always ready to render service, the reciprocation of knowledge and inquiries becomes perfect. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। उमज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। So this is a very instructive verse in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita. And here Krishna is giving us very clear directions about how to learn about the truth, that is Him. How do we do that? He says, learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. Inquire from Him how? Submissively, and render service unto Him. The self-realized soul can impart knowledge unto you because they have seen the truth. So these are great souls who are directly connected with Krishna because they are so pure that now that they have seen the truth, they are like transparent via media. Srila Prabhupada said, the spiritual master is transparent via medium. And only by satisfying the spiritual master, only by pleasing the spiritual master, can we hope to make advancement in our devotional life. So how do we do this? Here it says, you humbly submit to the spiritual master, you make inquiries, and you render service. All these things have to go together. You know, sometimes people think the spiritual master is just there to give me, you know, tattva, jnana. So they keep firing questions. Srila Prabhupada once said, you know, to one person who was asking question, said, I am not your question answering machine. So we must be very, very careful in our dealings with the spiritual master, because who is the spiritual master? He's the mercy manifestation of Krishna in this material world. So he's as good as God. So how careful we must be in our dealings, how much humble, submissive, filled with awe and reverence and respect and a sense of deep gratitude that someone from the spiritual world is here, come down to help me go back to the spiritual world. So our whole mood in front of the spiritual master is, I'm a blank slate. Srila Prabhupada said, you have to become like a blank slate. You know nothing, and the spiritual master will give you instructions, which is really the case. So, and the very first line of the purport says, the path of spiritual realization is undoubtedly difficult. So Prabhupada is not making any bones about this. He's making it very clear, it's very difficult. And Prabhupada has said on occasion, many times also, spiritual life, razor's edge. Razor's edge. Be very careful. You know, you can so easily, with a razor, it's so easy to get cut, isn't it? Or it's so easy if you're walking on something so narrow as a razor's edge. You can go on either side very easily. So we have to be so careful in spirit. Our spiritual life is the greatest gift we have. And we have to guard it like the Kohinoor diamond or more. Supposing you had a very, very valuable gem, extremely valuable gem, would you just leave it on the doorstep for anybody passing by to just look at it, pick it up and take it and go? No. How do people guard, you know, in museums and things like that, they have so many different layers of security. You cannot just go and see that diamond or that piece of jewelry or something. There are so much precautions so that nobody can snatch that piece of jewelry and go, because it's so valuable. Similarly, we must consider the gift of devotional service, the Bhakti Lata Beej, that we have been given by the spiritual master as the most precious and the most matchless gift of all, because it is. This is the kripa that we will be climbing up to go back to Krishna. So we have to guard it very carefully. We cannot allow anything to happen to it. So how do we make that Bhakti Lata Beej grow luxuriantly, nicely, and take us back home, back to Godhead? By following the process given to us by the predecessor acharyas and following the instructions given to us by Sri Krishna himself here in the Bhagavad Gita. And that is, follow the genuine bona fide spiritual master who's coming down in disciplic succession from the Lord himself. That is the first criteria. We have to be very discriminatory. We have to be very, very discerning. And we have to choose a bona fide spiritual master. Fortunately, we have a wonderful spiritual master. Like I was telling yesterday, you know, to someone, you know, it's like, I have to keep pinching myself. Wow, I really have such a wonderful spiritual master. I hope it's not a dream. It's real, isn't it? Like that. So we have such a wonderful spiritual master that we are blessed beyond compare. But there are many people who get cheated. They get fooled. Why? Because Srila Prabhupada says they want to be cheated. They want something cheap. They want something easy. They want something which will pander to their own desires for sense gratification and so on and so forth. So those who want to get cheated, get cheated. But we don't want to get cheated. We wanted someone genuine. And so Krishna saw that and sent us the bona fide spiritual master who is coming in the disciplic succession. Because only such a person who is personally chosen by Krishna can be Guru Tattva, and only he can impart real knowledge. This is not a show bottle thing. This is not you buy a bottle for 500 euros, drink it, and you become Krishna conscious. This is not a pill or a potion or a magic spell or a this or that. You know, you just buy it here or get it from somewhere and then you do jadu tona and then suddenly you're Krishna conscious. It doesn't happen like that. This is a very scientific, very systematic, very organized, and a very intelligent process. So we cannot manufacture our own process. We have to carefully follow the order of Guru, carefully follow the instructions of the Shastra, and carefully follow the process of bhakti. And we know for sure that if we do all these things slowly and surely, we will make advancement. And of course, there are do's, there are don'ts. There are the six things favorable for devotional service, six things unfavorable for devotional service. So we have to very carefully follow all these things so that we are not making any mistakes and we are not spoiling what is already there. So we want to be extremely careful and guard our Bhakti Lata Beej because the Lord himself is telling us how to do it. So we want to follow that process. We don't want to come up with our own mental speculation. We don't want to come up with concocted philosophy. We don't want to come up with all kinds of dry reasoning, as it says over here, or arguments, or independent study of books, etc., etc. No, this is not like that. This is a heart-to-heart transmission. And Srila Prabhupada says, as we become completely situated in pure devotional service, we will have a spiritual television in our heart, and we will be able to see the pastimes of the Lord. Of course, this is a very elevated stage. We cannot, you know, hope to jump over there. But this is how pure our hearts can become, because we will be entering into the pastimes ourselves. Now, again, as I said, this is not something we should take lightly or expect that it's going to happen overnight. But this is what Srila Prabhupada has said. So imagine we are going to be getting our spiritual bodies back. We are going to go back to the spiritual world by the mercy of the Guru. So how grateful, how humble, how submissive, and how carefully we must follow the instructions of the Guru. Make the words emanating from the mouth of our spiritual master one with your heart and do not desire anything else. This is the Guru Vandanam prayers that we sing every day. Guru Mukha Padma Vakya Chitte Te Koriya Aikya Arana Koriho Mani Asha. Do not desire anything else. Why? Because the only desire one should have is how to please my spiritual master. In that is actually my entire welfare. We must understand that our welfare, our self-interest is actually in following the words of the Guru, because his only interest is to make us Krishna conscious. This self-realized soul has no material desires whatsoever. He's only coming to help us, to save us, to bring us back to Krishna. How selfless and how loving is that? And so we must understand, with all the knowledge that we have been given now, with all these readings that we are doing, that the spiritual master is there to take us back to Godhead. And we have only one point program, as they say, how to please the spiritual master. So we must offer ourselves at his lotus feet, offer ourselves in full surrender and serve the spiritual master like a menial servant without false prestige. And this is not so easy because we are very conditioned and we have our own ideas of how the spiritual master should be, what kind of instructions he should give me, what kind of instructions if he gives, I will follow. And we come into that relationship also with our own anarthas, with our own concoctions, with our own preconceived notions, with our conditioning. So it's not so easy, but this should be the aim, that how can I surrender more? How can I follow more nicely? How can I become more humble? How can I become truly a servant of my Gurudev? How can I act in such a way that my spiritual master becomes pleased with me? Because this is the secret of advancement. It says very clearly, satisfaction of the self-realized spiritual master is the secret of advancement in spiritual life. So we want to be very, very careful and conduct ourselves in such a way that the spiritual master will be pleased to answer our humble inquiries, will be pleased to accept our humble service, and therefore, being pleased with us, he will remove the darkness of ignorance in our heart and give us real knowledge, so that we become free of what? The gunas. We are already entangled in that and we are suffering as a result of that. But the spiritual master can free us and situate us very nicely in devotional service. So we are no longer so much affected by the material pushings, you know, ups and downs and all those things. We no longer have the power to affect us so much because of the mercy of the Guru. Praptasya kalyana gunarna vasya vandesh Guru Shri Charanaravinda. The spiritual master is pouring mercy like a rain cloud on those who are suffering in the blazing fire of conditioned existence. See how merciful the spiritual master is. So we want to be in that position where we are always receiving clouds of pouring rains of mercy, isn't it? And so therefore, attitude should always be humble service. Humble service, inquiries, how can I do better? What am I supposed to do, Gurudev? Are you happy with me? Are you pleased with me? We are scared to ask these questions, isn't it? Because we think, what if Guru Maharaj says, I'm not happy with you, then I have to do something, so better not ask at all. No, this is not a good way to conduct ourselves. We are here for a very serious reason. So we shouldn't waste time in playing childish games like this. We must grow up. We must be very mature about this whole thing because, hey, any moment, Srila Prabhupada says, Maharaj Parikshit had 7 days. We don't know if we have even 7 minutes. And that's the truth. So why we should take any chances? Every day, let us make an attempt to please the spiritual master a little more than yesterday. Every day, let us make an attempt to do our devotional service a little better than yesterday. Every day, let us make an effort to chant our rounds much better than yesterday. So these are all the tests that will come. And unless one passes the test of the spiritual master and he sees that the disciple is really sincere, why will he bless that devotee unless he sees sincerity? Because when we are not sincere, what is the message we are giving? I'm not really interested in this. Then why will I receive that gift? Supposing you want to give me a gift, but I make it very clear by the way I'm reacting towards you. I'm not looking at you. I'm not paying attention. Even when you're speaking, I'm not really tuning into what you have to say. I'm indifferent even when you call me, and you're going to think, I don't know that this person even wants what I have to give. I don't know that this person even is willing to receive this gift that I have with me. Maybe I'll wait for a little time and, you know, see. So similarly, if our attitude is sort of indifferent or let's wait for some more time, I don't want to make so much spiritual advancement so fast. I think I'll go slow. I'll take it easy. I'll jog along for a little bit. I don't want to rush like a mad woman or madman. You know, let's go slow and easy and take it. If we have this kind of attitude, then the spiritual master sees that. oh, okay, this person is joined, but they're taking their own sweet time. All right, even I'll take my own sweet time to give them the mercy. It's a two-way street. So we want to be very sincere, because having come to Krishna consciousness, why waste time? Why should we pass up the opportunity and miss the chance to go back home? Let's make use of every moment to become more and more Krishna conscious. So any moment, if that test of death comes, we are ready. We can say, yes, we are ready. We want to be like that. We are not like that right now, but we want to be like that. So we want to pass all the tests that the spiritual master gives us so that we receive the blessings of genuine spiritual understanding. And for this, both blind following and absurd inquiries, these are not recommended. One should not just follow like a, you know, yes man, yes, 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 but without understanding or without making proper inquiries to understand what is it that the spiritual master wants me to do, and then do it nicely with intelligence, with understanding, with full comprehension. That is what is needed. Similarly, asking silly questions of the spiritual master is also condemned, because the spiritual master is not here to tell me which stocks and which shares I should buy. Should I invest in a car now? Should I do this? Should I do those things we ask our peers or our mentors and so on, because yeah, these things are also important. They can have a serious impact on our spiritual life, but we don't want to bother the spiritual master with things of this world, which are not directly related to our spiritual life. They have an indirect impact. So that also we must very carefully, thoughtfully, intelligently discuss with our mentors, with our peers, and not take every silly question, you know, which toothbrush should I use? Which sari should I wear? You know, not like that. We want to be very serious. We want to be very mature. We want to be very intelligent when coming in front of the spiritual master, because he is as good as God. That's who the spiritual master is. A bona fide spiritual master is by nature very kind towards the disciple. Therefore, when the student is submissive and always ready to render service, the reciprocation of knowledge and inquiries becomes perfect. Okay, I missed one line. Let me read that. Not only should one hear submissively from the spiritual master, but one should also get a very clear understanding from him in submission and service and inquiries. Yeah, I think I did speak about this. So we must get a very clear understanding of what is expected of us. We can ask all the questions we want so that we can get a clear understanding. But once we have understood, then we must move forward in execution. We must move forward to carry out the order of the spiritual master. And not all of us are brave enough immediately to take up whatever Guru Maharaj says. But that is why the spiritual master is considered such an ocean of mercy, because he's so patient, he's so kind, he's so compassionate. And he's always trying to help us follow that order. Even though in the beginning we may not be able to follow it, he empowers us as we slowly try more and more to make the advancement. He gives us mercy so that we can make advancement. So this is the process for advancing in spiritual life. And I thought it is important for us to hear, especially in view of the fact that just yesterday we had such a glorious Vyasa Puja ceremony to glorify our spiritual master. So we must all, and this is my humble request, my dear brothers and sisters, those of us who are initiated, please let us renew our vows and not fall back on the initiation vows that we made. Let us resolve that, okay, whatever has happened in the past is okay, but at least from today, let me keep my vow of chanting 16 rounds every day. Let me not break that, because this is so disheartening. This is very difficult for the spiritual master, because he suffers. When I break my vows, my spiritual master has to get diseases. My spiritual master gets nasty, bad dreams. My spiritual master suffers when I do something wrong. So at least let me not do something wrong to someone who is mercy manifested in this material world, who's come down for me. At least let us follow our initiation vows and chant our 16 rounds every day, no matter what. This is a vow which should never be broken. We can eat less, we can sleep less. In fact, Srila Prabhupada said, it's better to give up your life than to break your vows. It's that important. So my humble request to everyone is, let us at least take from now on our vows seriously, chant our 16 rounds every day, maintain the regulative principle nicely, ask our Guru Maharaj, what way can I serve you, Guru Maharaj? And then follow the instructions that come and try to make our life successful. Krishna Prem is waiting for us. The spiritual world is waiting for us. So why waste time? So thank you very much for listening so patiently to this spontaneous class. I humbly request you to forgive me if something is not to your liking or I have disappointed you in some way. Please forgive me. But we can now open up for questions, comments, realizations. Like that. Corrections.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you so much. That was a very nice class. Thank you.
You're always encouraging me, Brinda Mataji. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev. You're so kind and merciful that no matter what, you're always encouraging me in my service to Guru Maharaj. So thank you for that.
You are a savior, Mataji. Yeah, they're always to give spontaneous classes. Thank you so much. I request you, what is, if there are any questions, comments, realizations, please go ahead.
Krishna Mataji, thank you so much for the nice class, Mataji. Mataji, are you able to hear me?
Yes, there's a little bit of echo, but
yeah, I'm outside driving, Mataji. My question is like, as you said, like after initiation, we should take our vows seriously, suppose if anybody thinks like that, we should not do any offenses, better to not take initiation, how it will happen, Mataji? If one thinks like that, like better not to take initiation, why unnecessarily taking and not, if I don't follow, then it will affect Guru Maharaj. So if someone thinks like that, then what should we do in that case?
Many people talk like this. Many people talk like this. They say, this is very scary. What if I'm not able to keep the regulative principles? What if I cannot keep my vows? Better not to take initiation only, rather than take initiation and then break my vows and all that. It is an individual choice. Ultimately, nobody can be forced. But such a person is missing the chance. Such a person is missing the opportunity in this lifetime. They will have to again in the next lifetime overcome whatever obstacles they had. There is no, you can stay in this material world as long as you like. You can keep rotating birth after birth after birth after birth after birth. Nobody is stopping you. You can come back as many times as you want, taking birth again, going through, you know, being scrunched up in a womb and coming out and passing and then having to learn to walk and learn to talk and then go to school and do homework. Who wants to do all that? But if you want to, hey, you're welcome. And then grow up and then get a job and then get married and then all the problems that come with that and raise children and then all the problems that come with old age and disease and finally death. And then start all over again from scratch. How intelligent is that? Does a man or woman of intelligence really want to do that? So, you know, choice is theirs. Whoever is talking like this doesn't understand that it's in the human form of life that we actually must take initiation. This is actually a scriptural injunction. The Shastra said, Tad Vidhi, Tad Gurum Eva Ba. Tad Gurum Eva Bhigache. One must take the shelter, and one must take initiation, because only at this point actually human life actually begins. We have not even reached the human form of life if we have not taken initiation. Did you know that? Until then, it's just animalistic and your mind is in control. So what kind of life is that? But if that's what the life they want, welcome. Nobody's stopping you. It's a free world. You can do whatever you want. But what is the guarantee that you will even come back in human form of life? What if you're, you know, starting, if you start off like this, what's to stop you from saying, hey, I can have a drink here and there. Maybe I can have a little meat here and there. Because once you start thinking like that, you start making concessions about everything. Who knows whether you'll even have a human form next time around. Shall I tell you a story, Srimati? Would you like to hear?
Yes, Mataji, sure.
Okay, this is a real story. One young lady, she took in, and Japataka Maharaj himself related it to us. So this is straight from Guru Maharaj's mouth, you can say. One young lady took initiation. And then after a few years, you know, she's like, oh, well, yeah, I took initiation, but you know, this is a big bother. I've got lots of things to do. I've got a job. I'm a busy woman. I have to do so many. So she gave up. She gave up chanting. She wasn't really interested, but she continued at least to be a vegetarian and, you know, not do anything crazy like that. So, but she was not chanting her rounds. One fine day, maybe 15 years later, yeah, about 15 years later, her uncle was dying. She went and visited him in the hospital. She actually saw the Yamadutas. She got so terrified. She came running back to her Guru Maharaj, fell at his lotus feet, begged him to forgive her for being so, you know, indifferent to her vows, begged him to please forgive her, that she would start chanting her rounds again. She didn't want to face the Yamaduta. She didn't want to be subjected to the merciless lashings or whatever is coming, because she's, you know, falling prey to all kinds of. She just surrendered to her Guru Maharaj and she said, Guru Maharaj, please, 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 I implore you, I beseech you, I beg you, please forgive me. Please give me shelter. I want to start chanting again. I want to start doing everything right, because she had seen the Yamadutas. So she was actually pretty lucky, I would say, that she got such a fright that she could, you know, pick it up again. But what if you don't have that mercy? You will see the Yamadutas and then it's too late. So we don't want to run such risks. And to those who make such claims that it's better not to trouble the spiritual man, this is all just cop out. This is a cop out. And if we have some influence over them, we can say, hey, think twice, folks, because do you really want to come back again? What kind of body you will be having? If they're a little intelligent, maybe they'll get it. But most people, they don't want to hear anything. They've already made up their minds. And so we say, Hare Krishna, I'll pray for you. What else can we do? We have no control over others. If we can influence them, we try to wake them up. But you know, as Prabhupada said, you can wake up a man who's really sleeping, but a man who's pretending to sleep, you cannot wake him up, because he's making a pretense. He doesn't want to wake up. So free choice is given to everyone. Krishna never forces us to love him. So we cannot force anybody. Is that helpful? Or it made you depressed?
No. Thank you so much, Ma. Thank you. Very nice class. Thank you, Ma.
Okay.
You are my savior.
No. Krishna is everyone's savior. Krishna is the only one who can save everyone. Remember that. Never ever think that anybody else can save you except Krishna, except Guru and Krishna. Only Guru and Krishna can save us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I thought you would like the real life story.
Thank you, Mataji. That was a wonderful answer and nice story. Mm-hmm. We have one question in the chat by Rishabh Prabhu.
Okay.
Prabhuji, what would you like to ask? Please go ahead if you want to ask. Okay, I can ask. Thank you for the points from your heart. How to renew our vow for four regulative principles? Should we question, are we strictly following them or not? Or something else? Any comment?
Okay, please accept my humble obeisances, Bishop Prabhu. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to our Gurudev. Yes, certainly, if we have even a grain of doubt about any of the things that we are following, we should ask questions, we should gain clarity, we should gain clear understanding, and we should be very confident then that we are following properly. We should not have any doubts about it. So you must ask questions and you must gain clarity on everything that you're signing up for. What am I signing up for? What are these four regulative principles? What am I supposed to do? What am I not supposed to do? We must gain complete clarity on these things and ask all the questions we need to get a very clear understanding about what is expected of us, what is the standard we have to follow. No meat eating, which means what? No eating fish, meat, eggs, no onion, no garlic. It means everything, right? Not just meat. It means so many other things too. No gambling, no intoxication, no illicit sex. Now in the area of illicit sex is the maximum questions because people don't really understand that what is illicit sex, you know, and that's a whole question. That's a whole, especially for Grihastha, this is a very important question to understand. But that's a whole class. I'm not going to go into that. But the point is, yes, one must gain complete clarity so that we know we are strictly following and we are not in any doubts about it. How to renew our vow? Should we ask questions? Yes. I hope I have answered it to your full satisfaction. How about the subtle levels of the... Yeah, of course, of course. Definitely, you know, we must really go into the details of understanding this. I remember writing to my Guru Maharaj early in my married life. And of course, Guru Maharaj being very compassionate, kind, merciful, understanding, but also very strict about the etiquette, which I didn't know at that time. He directed me to Malati Mataji. He said, these questions you should put to a lady. You can write to her and you can ask her all the questions you need to. I was very innocent. I didn't know. He's my spiritual master. I will ask him what exactly does it. So he directed me to Malati Mataji and asked me to ask all the questions I want about married life, you know, basically. So if we are sincerely trying to understand, the spiritual master will give us the directions and will give us the understanding. There is a whole article, Ibrisha Prabhu, if you're actually interested in reading, a very nice lengthy article by Matsarya Das of Italy. It's called Illicit Sex, capital I, small I, or something to that effect. But there's a whole article. If I find it, I will email it to you. But it gives a very detailed explanation. In that, Prabhu explains that a married couple that is genuinely trying, they may not immediately be able to come to the highest stage, but at least they are trying. At least they have an understanding and they're trying to move towards that goal, should be encouraged, not condemned, not humiliated, not made fun of. Because, hey, we are all in the shower. When we first came to I was, of course, born in a very strict South Indian family. There was no question of meat eating, gambling, intoxicating. So for me, it was different. But if I were born in the Western world, smoking, drinking, these things are like, you know, norm. When people come to Krishna consciousness, you know, only slowly they understand that all these things have to be given up. So similarly, we may not be able to jump to the highest level. That is why it is very very important to understand all these things and then take our vows properly so that then we are not breaking anything. But we must be very compassionate and we must help those who are struggling with the various aspects of devotional life, and we must encourage them and we must help them. So Grihastha Vision team has a whole section in the Heart and Soul Connections book for Grihasthas about dealing with intimacy, actually, in married life. It's a very nice write-up. Partha Prabhu has written about it, about how it has such a deep impact on married life. It's very important. You know, we come together in matrimony to fulfill so many needs. So this is a very legitimate and a very necessary need that must be properly honored, because dissatisfaction in married life can give rise to so many problems. So we don't want that people suffer. They must have clear understanding, and they must be having good guidance on how to follow also, so that their married life doesn't suffer. I hope that gives you some indication of where to look further, because that's a whole class in itself. You can look up Grihastha Vision Team website. You can look up the book, Heart and Soul Connections, A Vaishnav Guide for Marriage, Service and Love. In that, there's a whole chapter, Affection and Intimacy in Marriage, to talk about this aspect of married life. And Matsarya Prabhu's article. I think all those things will be giving you a lot of information. Thank you. Thank you for asking a very important question.
Thank you, Mataji. Sudha Mataji, please go ahead.
Yeah, Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna, Danu Pranam Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Guru Maharaj. Thank you, Mataji.
All glories to Guru Maharaj, all glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Thank you, Mataji, for the very enlightening class. So, Mataji, just to follow up on Srimati Devi Mataji's question, like regarding initiation. I mean, we are not initiated, but still we try to follow, like chanting, we do all, like, you know, offering prasadam, like follow regulative principles. So still, like, will it be effective? Like, because we are not initiated and still following the, like, instructions of Guru Maharaj. So will still we get the mercy, like, or we have to be initiated?
No, it's once you're aspiring and once you have taken shelter, once you are, you know, serving Guru Maharaj, once you are following his instructions, you have received the shelter. That is what is meaning of aspiring disciple, that the Guru has taken you under his shelter, and is there's a period of testing where you are testing the Guru, and the Guru is also testing you. So definitely you are under the shelter. So definitely you're receiving the mercy. It's not like, okay, only on initiation day from this point on, I'll get the mercy. You've already received the mercy because Guru Maharaj is giving you his shelter, and you have come into the association of the God family. You're receiving so much knowledge via his daily classes. You're asking questions. You're gaining clarity. You're, you know, serving Guru Maharaj now when he came and so on. So of course you're getting the mercy. Never have any doubts about that.
Okay, Mataji. Because I thought, like, initiation, like, you know, as you said, like, you know, after initiation is like your spiritual life starts. So, I mean, not initiated.
Initiation seals the deal. You know, it's the legal contract, so to speak. You know, when you sign for when you join a company, you know, a few weeks before that, you may be going every day and doing the training program and everything. But when you finally sign the contract, that's the day you are considered employed by the company.
Oh, okay.
But it doesn't mean that those few weeks before that, you're not part of the company, because you are. You know, so similarly, you have come under the shelter, but the initiation is the... Okay, now this is it. This is my spiritual master. My spiritual master has accepted me, given me my spiritual name, and is accepting that he will guide me back home, back to Godhead.
Okay.
This is actually a spiritual deal. The spiritual master promises to take the disciple back to Godhead. The disciple promises to give to surrender and follow all the instructions of the guru. So this is like the contract. This is sealing the deal, so to speak.
Okay, Mataji. So it's basically like understanding is like you're surrendering to your spiritual master when you take initiation. Okay, Mataji. Thank you. I have one other question. It's okay, I can ask.
Yeah, sure.
Like Mataji, you said you can ask Guru Maharaj like questions like, you know, how can I do better? How can I please you? Like that. So regarding like since like I'm new to this group and an aspiring disciple, so will Guru Maharaj will understand the disciple's heart? Like, you know, if I ask like, okay, how can I improve? How can I like, you know, see my faults, anything? So will Guru Maharaj will be able to like help with these things or?
Do you have any doubts?
No, Mataji. Is it okay if I can ask? Because since like I'm very far away and I'm just like attending on the Zoom and like, you know.
The spiritual master has divine vision. The spiritual master can see far, far, far beyond what we can even think or understand, because they're empowered by Krishna to understand the disciple. He is uniquely empowered to take that disciple back home, back to Godhead. So Krishna gives him all the understanding about that disciple to do his job, so to speak.
Okay.
So never have any doubts. If you read about Prabhupada, you read about memories, you read about what the first generation of disciples had to say, you will see very clearly how empowered the spiritual master is and how he knows the mind of the disciple even before sometimes the disciple knows what he wants and what he doesn't want.
Yes.
So the spiritual master is divinely empowered by Krishna.
Okay.
He knows everything about the disciple that he needs to know to help that disciple move forward in spiritual life.
Okay, Mataji. Got it. Yeah, thank you, Mataji. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
I remember you're reminding me of a very amusing incident, you know, very, very early in my relationship with Gurudev. When I met him, I just knew, you know, this is someone. I didn't know so much about words like disciple, spiritual master, initiation, this thing. But I just knew when I met him that this is the person whom I'm going to take guidance from. I just knew that in my heart. And over a period of time, you know, I was asking questions and Guru Maharaj, you know, was answering and so on. So I think I met him again after almost a year and I told him, Guru Maharaj, you know me. Because by then it had become very clear that this is a person who knew me in previous lifetimes.
Okay.
And he said, yes, I know you. Take charge, Lakshmi. Because I had that nature at that time. I hope I'm better now. My name used to be Lakshmi in those days before initiation. So he knew me from previous lifetimes.
Oh, okay.
So don't have any doubts on that score. The spiritual master is in perfect knowledge of how to guide his disciple back home, back to Godhead, and knows everything about the disciple that he needs to know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, wonderful, Mataji. Thank you so much for clearing this. Yeah. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. You're in very good hands. Don't you worry.
No, Mataji. No, not like that. Just ask. Thank you so much.
Or rather, I should say you are at very wonderful lotus feet.
Yes, Mataji, definitely. Thank you. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Mataji.
Yes, Vrinda. I can see that Sukhava has made a very nice, if I can understand, it is probationary period. Yes, that's right. That initial time, you know, you see whether, is this really my spiritual master? And even the spiritual master sees, is this really my disciple? And sometimes the spiritual master says, I'm not your spiritual master. This has also happened. People have been aspiring for 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. And the spiritual master and the disciple finally understand, no, this is not my spiritual master. And the spiritual master will guide you. No, this is the person whom you must take initiation from is someone else. That can also happen. So it is a testing time and it is something where you will know for sure, is this my Guru Maharaj or someone else is going to be my Diksha Guru. Yeah, very, very nice way to put it, probationary period. Thank you, Sukhavaha.
Hare Krishna Mataji, so nice to see you back in the form. I'm so happy to see you. Please accept my humble obeisance. Thank you so much.
For love all glories to Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev, and actually all glories to my sweet God family here. Samyadatri and Gabriela, they literally nursed me back to health. Believe me, I was like a baby on the bed and they had to take care of me and do everything. Oh my gosh. You know, it was really, I understood what is the love of a God family for the first time in my life.
Amazing.
No, I would say first time. I would say that I have received love. I'm not saying no. But at such a selfless, deep, intimate level, you know, to keep bringing food up and down all the time and bring tea and bring medicines and take care of you like that, because you're just like a baby. All you can do is get up and eat and get up and go to the bathroom and then fall down in the bed and sleep. Literally, that's all I could do. Who will take care like that? Who will take care like that? Isn't that wonderful? Oh my God, I can tell you that Krishna just showed me how much love there is in our God family. I'm so grateful for that. So
you are an amazing personality, Mataji. Seriously.
I'm amazingly fallen. That's what you mean.
No. I remember when I was in the shelter, and then you inspired me so much and helped me so much. So you are such a helpful person. So of course Krishna is going to arrange help for you.
Thank you very much for saying some kind words, but really, my gratitude and debt that is irrepayable is here now. I don't know how I can ever repay Samyadatri and Gabriela. I'm forever in their debt now.
Yeah. I know. They are amazing devotees as well. So, yeah.
True.
We are so lucky to have such a lovely God family.
Yes. Guru Maharaj ki jai. And you won't believe this, because I was so sick. And I was longing for some Indian food. You know, Manasi lovingly prepared some nice Indian snacks for me. And Dipteshwar has lovingly packed it up for me. And they've sent it all the way to Slovenia. We are just waiting for the customs to clear it so we can all sit together and enjoy all this package full of love. Aww. Who will do such things except God family? Tell me.
True.
Yeah, thank you for allowing me to share. You were trying to ask a question, Sukhavaha?
No. I just wanted, it was really nice class, so I just wanted to say thank you for that.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for accepting this humble, simple, very basic class in such a sweet and kind and compassionate way. I am grateful that everybody tolerates me and accepts whatever little humble service I'm offering. It's so much patience and compassion and tolerance. I'm so grateful. Hare Krishna. Good to see you.
Hare Krishna. Good to see you too.
I wish more of my God family will turn on the camera so I can see them. This is the only way I can meet you all. Well, if we are... there are no more comments or questions or realizations. Vrinda, what do you think?
Yeah, okay, Mataji.
Oh, but Sudha still has her hand raised. Maybe she wants to ask some more questions.
Yeah, Mataji.
No, Mataji, thank you. I think it's previously I did. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Okay, Mataji, so if there are no more questions, then with your permission, we will wrap up today's class. Thank you so much once again for giving us your time and association. It was a very, very wonderful class, Mataji.
You are so kind. Thank you. Thank you very much for being so kind and compassionate towards me. I'm very grateful that all the devotees also tolerate me and put up with me. I'm really and truly blessed. And please pray for me to do better so that I can please Guru Maharaj more and more and more. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. And Vishnu Prabhu is apologizing for not joining today, but I really hope that we get to hear from him soon in future.
Oh, yes, definitely. One day everyone will be giving class, believe me, because Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj wanted. One day Vrinda will give class, Sudha will give class, Madhavananda Prabhu will give class, Philip Prabhu will give class, Rishabh Prabhu will give class. Everybody will be giving class. Why? Because Guru Maharaj wants it.
Thank you for encouraging, Mataji.
Raha will be giving class, Sukhamaha will be giving class, Savyadatri will be giving class. Actually, Prabhupada said, everyone should be able to speak something about the philosophy because that's why we are here. We got convinced by this wonderful philosophy and that's why we joined Krishna Consciousness. So we can just speak whatever bit we know. That's all. It's nothing, it's not rocket science.
Thank you for those encouraging words, Mataji. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
You pray for me. You pray for us. Okay. Thank you.
And you pray for me. It's a deal. Hare Krishna. Guru Maharaj ki.
Jai.
His Holiness Chandamouli Swami Guru Maharaj ki.
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai.
Everyone
Hare Shri Devi Mataji ki jai.
Jai.
Vancha kalpataravyascha kripa sindhu
jai vachapatita nam
pavitro
vaishnavo namaha
ananta koti vaishnavanda ki
jai.
Thank you so much Mataji. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you my dear Vrinda for hosting us so nicely and taking care of all the questions and the comments and the chat and the this and the that and pulling up the words, so many different things. Thank you so much.
All my pleasure, Mataji. I'm happy to serve. Thank you for the opportunity.
Hare
Krishna. Thank you, devotees. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.